So you may have noticed that more and more mic preamps are beginning to feature input impedance controls. The first one of these that I tried was the Tab Funkin'Work, kind of Telefunken-esque mic preamp, and to be honest, I was shocked by how much the impedance control affected the tone when I was tracking, especially with dynamic microphones. Today I'm going to show you how to add that same exact kind of impedance control to any of your mic preamps. It's going to involve one electronically significant component, a couple jacks and a box, and just a little bit of wiring. So let's get started with the most basic concept, which is what is impedance? As an audio engineer or an audio enthusiast, I'm sure you've heard that word. It's kind of a hot term these days. Impedance, the electronic engineering definition, is that impedance is just the degree to which a circuit or a component resists the flow of current. Now that might not be immediately obvious to you as a non-electronic engineer, so let's take a look at how that plays out in terms of a microphone interfacing with its preamp. So I have a very stripped down, simplified schematic here with my microphone represented by an AC signal and my microphone preamp. Now obviously a real mic preamp has a lot more circuitry than this, but I have reduced it down to just its input impedance, which is a typical 1.5 kilo-ohms. Now where do we get that number? 1.5 kilo-ohms represents the modern thinking, or rather the modern standard about impedance in terms of connecting pro audio devices. The modern standard is that the input impedance of any device needs to be at least 10 times that of the output device driving it. Okay, so what that means is, say we have a microphone. The kind of standard range for microphone impedance is 150 ohms. So the input impedance of the next stage, that is the mic preamp, is 10 times that, or 1500 ohms. So that's how we arrive at this standard. Now that's the ideal situation for hooking up two pieces of audio gear in the modern era, but what we're going to do today is we're going to change that ratio of 10 to 1 and see how that draws different tonal options out of the microphone. So how do we go about changing the input impedance of a mic preamp without opening it up and hacking apart the guts? In fact, there's a very easy way. All we're going to do is add some more impedance in parallel with that of the mic preamp by means of a resistor. Now, as I said before, we're reducing the ratio, right, from 10 to 1 down to something 2 to 1, 1 to 1. So how do we reduce impedance by adding more impedance? The answer is we're adding impedance in parallel. And when you add impedance in parallel, you not only add more impedance, you add more conductance. That is, you give electrons another path through the circuit, making the circuit more conductive and reducing the overall impedance seen by the microphone. Now, if we know the mic preamp impedance that we have, and we know the impedance that we desire, it's a very simple formula to calculate the impedance that we need to put in parallel. I've got some typical values right here. I've got 600 ohms as my desired input impedance. This is the old standard and is featured on a lot of vintage audio gear. I've got my modern standard 1.5K, and according to the formula, which I'm not going to go through right now, we need a 1K resistor in parallel. This is really easy. We could just actually put a resistor in a cable and be done with it for this exact situation. But we don't always know the input impedance of our preamps. It's not usually specified. And we don't always want the same input impedance for dynamic mics. So what we really want is something with a variable impedance where we can set it by ear, just as many new mic preamp designs do these days. The answer now is to add a potentiometer in place of that one resistor. Potentiometer is nothing more than a variable resistor if you wire it this way. So what we've got now with a 1K potentiometer is we can swipe through the entire range of useful input impedances and choose by ear which tone we like for that application with that microphone. So this is one of those lucky situations in audio and electronics where we have one component that actually gives us a quite ideal solution to our problem. So before we get into exactly how to build this thing, I'm going to get John Bourne from Shure on the line, who's going to tell us exactly how this thing works and also what Shure's current research is about how Impedance affects their SM57 dynamic microphone. So John and I had a Google Hangout. I was still getting the hang of the format, so the first question got cut off. But the question I'm about to ask John is that some people claim that input impedance is one of the most important factors in how a preamp sounds. And I'm just about to ask John if Shure's findings bear that out.
Yeah, so some things happen actually when you load a dynamic microphone down with a load ratio less than 10 to 1, say maybe 2 to 1 or 3 to 1. Mm-hmm. And that has to do with, because of a dynamic microphone doesn't have a linear output impedance across its frequency range, that has to do with the mechanical coil and the diaphragm, and that assembly has a resonance frequency to it. And at its resonance frequency, it's going to have a higher output impedance. So on a SM57, in the low mids, it's going to have a higher output impedance. And on a condenser microphone, this isn't the case because the circuit design can have a very linear output impedance across its frequency range.
Right, so what you're saying is when we load down a mic, a dynamic mic like a 57, we can change the frequency response because the output impedance of the mic isn't linear. So whatever we do to the impedance of the mic is going to change different frequencies in different ways.
It definitely will. And we have a graph of that, actually, that we can pull up. And this graph depicts, the black line depicts its frequency response with a 10 to 1 load ratio. And the red line depicts its frequency response with basically a 1 to 1 load ratio, where the output impedance and the input impedance are matched. It's not showing the effect of sensitivity. You're going to take a 6 dB hit in sensitivity, mm-hmm. So you're going to have to make that up on your mic pre. But you're going to see a drop in the low mids where the resonance frequency occurs. You're also going to see a tail off in the top end too, because the output impedance is also very high in the high frequency range.
Interesting. Looking at this graph, this is really interesting. So as we lower the input impedance seen by the mic, we get a little bit of tapering off at the high end of the frequency spectrum. But it actually looks like it's making the low mids more linear with respect to the rest of the frequency range. There's not as much of a bump there.
That is true. Some could call it a real gentle roll off. Mm-hmm. But basically, we're damping down that resonance frequency. We're resisting it even more, which is basically causing this loss in low mids right around the frequency response. And this is true of pretty much any dynamic microphone. Just by its design, it's going to have a resonance frequency to that diaphragm assembly, and it's going to have a higher output impedance at that frequency range. There's nothing wrong with loading a microphone down with a lesser ratio.
Right.
Just knowing what you're doing to it is good to know. And if it's another tool in your arsenal of ways to capture good audio, That's a great thing to have.
Yeah, awesome. Well, thanks a lot for taking the time to explain this to us, and I appreciate it. Let's talk soon.
My pleasure. Thanks, Peterson.
Thanks.
All right, enough theory already. Let's build this thing. What do we need for our build? We need two XLR jacks, one male, one female. We need a box with XLR holes drilled in it. Now, this is not the easiest thing to do if you don't have a mill or a drill press, so you can alternately substitute quarter-inch holes if you have the right adapter cables to go from your XLR microphone to the quarter-inch in and out. We need hookup wire. Anything between 22 and 26 gauge should work fine. And we need a 1 kilo-ohm linear potentiometer with solder lug terminals. For tools, we need our standard hand tools, a wire cutter and needle nose pliers. And we also need a soldering iron, of course. Okay, let's get building.
First thing we're going to do is cut down our hookup wires to a manageable size.
For our signal wires, that means about half the length of the case. And for the ground wire, which in my case is green, that means one length is going to be 3/4, and one length is about 1/4 of the length of the case. Then we're going to prepare the tips of our wires by tinning them, that's stripping them, and then applying a little solder to the end. Now let's solder them to the XLR jack. I like to do this by heating the pins of the XLR jack first and putting a little solder in there, and then inserting the tinned hookup wire and melting that into the pins. The ground wire goes to pin 1, and then the signal wires go to pins 2 and 3. Next, we're going to twist the signal wires, pins 2 and 3, together as tightly as we can. For balanced signals, this actually helps them reject noise. Now for our other XLR jack, the one with the short ground wire, we're just going to put the other end of that into the fourth pin, the ground tab of the XLR jack. We're not going to solder yet. Now let's choose the pins for the potentiometer. I'm checking it with a digital multimeter, and when I twist to the right, I want the value to go up, and to the left, I want it to go down. Now that we've chosen our pins, put like signals together into the two pins. Now it doesn't matter which pin goes where. There's no polarity here. This is basically just a resistor. So insert both of the wires from each jack, and then solder them together. And finally, we're going to take our other ground wire, the long one, and insert it into that chassis pin, and solder both of our ground wires together. This gives us one point of contact to the case for our ground wires. All right, all set. So there's not much to it, right? I encourage you to build one of your own. I've got some more info, including a bill of materials and some other build tips on the full blog post that goes with this video. You can find a link to that in the comments. And if you are not the drilling type or the component sourcing type, I've also put together some kits. I've got one right here. Not much to it, but all the holes are pre-drilled and it does include everything you need to build one of these guys, and I'm only asking about $20. So thanks so much for watching. Enjoy your build. Please subscribe, and I will play you out with some footage of me drilling these kits. Thanks a lot.